Washington, D.C. is a city filled with national treasures. Among them is a native daughter who keeps the richness of jazz, the American art form, alive.
Shirley will be here as long as her career continues on, because this is home.
She's a national treasure. She's a world treasure.
Mrs. Horne conveys an intimate charm, an inimitable depth that inevitably draws the listener in, holding them to her every nuance. Shirley Horne, would you please come forward?
In the beginning, there was music, and that's what I remember. You know, I remember being in my grandmother's parlor. You know, I was like 3 years old. I remember the piano. I remember getting up on the stool and trying to, you know, to pick at the piano and whatever. And the first thing I remember is music in my life. As a child, I was involved in good music, good singers. My mother sang all the time. She wasn't a singer, but around the house, that's what I heard. Yeah, I heard the good music, and mother always sang. My grandmother told my mother, she said, give Shirley piano lessons. And I would go there, because then your grandmother had a parlor, you know, that was for company. You know, cold or hot, I would go in there and screw around that little round seat, get on there and pick at the piano. That's the only thing I wanted to do. I didn't want to play with the kids.
When I think of Shirley, I think of a little reed-like, if you will, person. Slim fingers. Her eyes gave one the impression that she was seeing something that you didn't see. She just had a quality about her, unassuming, there was nothing pretentious at all, just Shirley. That's always the way I thought of her.
At the age of 4, Shirley couldn't read or write, yet she distinctively knew how to play those 88 keys.
I wanted it. I wanted, like, meat and bread, water. You know, I had no other way to feel about it. I played for Sunday school, and when I was about 12, I guess I was long enough to touch the pedals, so I played a little pipe organ, you know, as best I could, you know, but I was raised in the church.
By 12, Shirley had outgrown music lessons by her first instructor. Her uncle introduced her to Frances Hughes, a choral teacher at Howard University School of Music.
She saw so much in me, and my uncle, Dr. I.B. Horne, they got together and started the Junior School of Music at Howard University.
Well, when Dr. Horne brought Shirley to me, naturally I want to know how well she can sight read. And I put Brahms A-flat major lullaby up in front of her. And this, as I'm saying, this little person that's just sort of going through on her own beam, I should say, sat down and innocently looked. The first chord she struck was the correct one. She went from the beginning to the end of what was supposed to have been Brahms' lullaby in A-flat, straight through in B-flat, and not an expression on her face to indicate that she was, to her, that she was not reading what was on that page. Mm-hmm. Obviously, she had heard it, I guess.
I had to come from junior high school at Shaw Junior High School on the streetcar. It'd be cold, you know. Then I'd walk up the hill to the music schools, get out, and I don't know the name of the streets anymore. And I was alone. But I wanted to get to those pianos, and I was always trying to get to a grand piano. There weren't many then.
Everything at all that I asked her to do, or that I tested her ear, she did it still with that innocent look on her face. And it really made me nervous. I went to the telephone. I called Miss Madeline Coleman, who was head of the theory department at Howard University School of Music. And the students used to say behind her back that she could teach a frog, she could teach anything, anybody. She was super as a teacher. So I called Miss Coleman and I said, Miss Coleman, I have a little girl here and I don't know what to do with her. I mean, she blew my mind. And I'm describing all the things that she does, that she was doing, and Miss Coleman said. And I'm going to say it like Miss Coleman said it, because it has a prophetic sound. She said, you keep her. She said, one day, she'll make you proud.
But she saw something in me that was wonderful, you know. But when she came into my life, you know, I'd had two music teachers. One was kind of a, now I can talk about her. She was just kind of a little milquetoast piano teacher, right? Dr. Hughes said, here you go, you play like this, blah, 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 blah. You know, she never hit me with anything, but she was so positive. And she gave me the strength that I have right now today.
Shirley studied the classical music of W.C. and Rachmaninoff. As for her first love on the piano...
You know, I heard O Garner. I guess I was about 12, 13 years old, and he had a hit record called Penthouse Serenade. He wrote so many beautiful songs, and he was so lyrical, and at that time, I copied him note for note.
While performing one of Garner's tunes at an afternoon tea party, her aunt gave her the surprise of her life.
So when I got through playing, my aunt came down, came and took me down. She said, I want you to meet Mr. Earl Garner. He was sitting at the table. But I almost fainted, you know. I was so nervous. I can't remember how I've ever been that nervous. And he kissed my hand, he hugged me. He was a little short man, you know. I said, okay, I'm gonna die right here. But that was the beginning, Earl Garner. You know, I loved him, I love him today.
After graduating from Dunbar High School, Shirley received a scholarship to attend Juilliard in New York City. Family finances dictated that she remain in D.C., where she worked on crossing over to jazz music with the help of local jazz legend Buck Hill.
Buck, yeah, yeah. It's my sweet pie, yeah. See, when I was trying to learn how to play jazz, and Buck was already in the... playing in the joints, you know. And he's the only one who let me sit in, you know, because it's hard to go from classics to jazz.
You know. Oh, yeah, jazz is all you. It's just you coming out, you know. Classical, you're playing somebody else's notes, you know, and ideas, music and thoughts. And you're playing a bunch of little, you know, you're looking at black and white, right? When it comes to you wanting to do your music, you have to step inside yourself.
But Buck was the only nice one, because they'd see me coming joints and musicians with his musician would say, here she comes again, she wants to sit in. I said to myself, one of these days.
When Shirley didn't see, when she graduated from high school, she could have gone to college, music school. She chose to go straight from high school into the entertainment business, jazz.
After releasing her first album, her introduction to New York City came with a surprise call.
I was at my mother-in-law's home at breakfast, early in the morning, you know, big table and all this buttermilk biscuits and fried chicken right off the ground and all that kind of stuff. And the phone rang. My mother-in-law said it was for me. So who is it? I got a little irritated. I'm getting ready to eat buttermilk biscuits, great big. So I went to the phone. I said, hello. And he said, it's Miles Davis. I want you to come to New York. Some people I think you should meet. I said, okay. But I thought about it. So we came on up the road and I said, Chef, I think I better go to New York. And I did. I called a friend, family friend, and he met me at the train station and went there to the house. And when Miles had four or five kids, little kids then. And to let me know that this was for real, these kids were singing songs from my first album. The way I did it at the Vanguard, because he wanted me to open for him, and he told Max Gordon that if she doesn't open for me, I'm not going to play, you know? And so that was the beginning, you know, my introduction to New York. And it was great. It's wonderful. Yeah, when I think back, you know, I think of Miles Davis. I remember very early on, you know, here I'm in New York. I know nothing. I'm in the Vanguard. And he was like an uncle who said, you can't sit on the bar. Well, I like to smoke, right? You can't smoke. You know, I had to sit in the back with the rest of the musicians, all the great musicians, which was wonderful, but when I come out from the back area there, I saw everyone that I'd seen that I had on my record albums. You remember the pictures on the record albums? They were all there, you know? And I was, he'd go in the back. I didn't rebel because he knew best for me at that time, at that place in New York. I was a child, really, you know. And he said, tell me, you don't talk to this, you don't talk to that. And I, when I was there, I would eat fast food and all that stuff. You know, and I put weight on, and he used to make me come up to his house on then 77th Street. And maybe go in the basement and work out, pull those things and stuff. No. Because there was no smoking, no drinking of beer. Then he'd feed me veal, broiled food and stuff like that, you know. And he loved me, and I loved him. I loved him.
Even when Miles passed away, too, you know, we were going to Japan. She went a day early. So when we got to Japan, the driver told us that Miles had passed. And as soon as we got there, we went right down to Shirley's room. Well, she was a mess. And that's. There's nobody can say anything, you can't do anything, you know. What are you gonna do?
Well, that tribute to Miles was a little long, you know, a long, long time coming. You won't forget me. Okay, that's a song that, this is right. In 1964, my grandmother passed. It was so dear to me, and I had to leave New York and come to Washington. And when I was leaving, I told Miles, I said, we're going to record this one day together.
Initially, she just wanted Miles with the trio. And then it kind of got out of that perspective. And then all of these other great people came in on that session.
You won't forget me.
He always, I can't play that kind of music. Makes my lips sore and all that stuff. You're going to do this for me. So we got together at the studio. We hadn't seen each other for a long time. And we were standing there, we were talking about old times and our problems and stuff. And he did that sketch right on a piece of paper. I didn't pay too much attention. We were just talking about the music and stuff. He just sketched. He said, "This is for you." And I saved that. And it's very special to me.
And he and Shirley were like two kids in a sandbox, you know. It was something to behold.
After seven previous nominations, Shirley Horne's tribute to Miles Davis won for Best Jazz Vocal Performance in the 1999 41st Annual Grammy Awards.
Thank you very much. It's very special. Thank the Almighty. Thank my family. All my friends at Verve Records. My right-hand person, Sheila Mathis. And my soulmates, Steve Williams and Charles Abels. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I really didn't think about winning, you know. The only one I felt that I deserved to win was Here's to Life, you know, that one. And I didn't, and I I'm there and I'm gonna go to the affair. You know, the record company requested I go. But I thought about it later after I finally got out of backstage. It's nice to be nominated by your peers.
I was glad for, very proud. And it's a long time coming, you know, because to me, she should have been recognized years ago.
Shirley's musical career began to soar by the mid-60s. With the arrival of her one and only child, she made a personal choice to make her family her first priority.
In Washington, if you don't leave and you stay here, you're always considered, you know, local. But she, during that time when they say, well, when she did raise her family, her daughter, she was still working. Not much. She wasn't traveling. And I think that's the misconception, I think. I don't know. But she's always told me, Steve, people always say, I didn't retire. I didn't stop, you know, I didn't stop playing. You can't stop playing.
So I'm sure that Shirley got a chance to really fully develop her repertoire, you know? Because when you have that kind of time and you really love music, you practice. You practice and you expand your repertoire.
You know, after I got married about 4 years and then I was pregnant with my daughter. And I said, okay, I'm gonna be cool at home. And, you know, because she needed me as much as I needed her.
When I think about my mom, Shirley Horne, I think of love, music, and rough. No. No, I think of love. I think of love, music, love of family. Very devoted to our family.
I come from a family where my mother was there when I came home from school, you know, and on Sunday I played for Sunday school and church, you know, and had love and respect for my people, my family.
Well, I'm glad she stayed home with me to, you know, bring me up proper, you know, to know what's important, home and family.
First, I started to try to teach her a little. She was five, right? And I discovered I'm not a teacher. I was a little rough with her, and she rebelled.
I probably fell on the floor and cried Hollywood. You know, that's what we used to call it, right? I'd get on the floor and throw a tantrum. Mom said, "That's right, baby, cry Hollywood." And I just perform, flipping up.
She did pretty well with the violin, but she lost interest. Then she wanted the guitar. So I got the guitar. I'm losing patience, right? Because I wanted music with a passion. I just, you know, I could just. So that was the end of that. I said, okay, well, but I got honor rolls, you know, I got right on through. She's very smart. She was like 21 years old. She said, come with it. Mom, guess what? I said, what? I want to study piano. I just hung up the phone. I said, click. Mom, why you do that to me? I said, I'm not going to be bothered with you. I wanted that so much, you know. But she wasn't interested, and so, and hey, if you're not, let it rest. I have no regrets, because I got a beautiful daughter who's very intelligent. She's beautiful inside and out. You know, she's my creation, you know. And I gave her all I had to give, you know. I'd do it again, you know.
From my perception, I think it was that change from Steeplechase and one or two others I think she was with before then. But when she signed up with Verve, everything just seemed to start moving really quick. Well, I guess I was an adult at that point. She really got busy. And albums, you know, more often. And international touring. And it's just been going up and up since then.
When this Here's to Life came, I knew I was going to have Johnny. It had to be, you know. Here's to Life was a song I heard, and
no regrets. I still believe.
I just heard a bit of it, but it hit me so. I knew it was my song. I had to sing that song.
Johnny Mandel really worked closely with us to get what he wanted, so he could orchestrate it and define it as he saw it and provide the colors as he saw it, embellish it as he felt it should be embellished.
I said, I trust you implicitly, and he did the whole nine yards.
Here's to Life was Shirley Horne's re-entry to the jazz mainstream. It won Billboard's 1992 Jazz Album of the Year and remained number one on the charts for 17 weeks.
I don't like all that pomp and circumstance, that fluff. That's not me.
The interruption in her life was the fact that she had to attend the ceremonies. I think that because she did the work fine, and they say, well, Shirley, you got the Grammy. Fine. She's lovely, lovely. But right now I got a pot of greens that's on there and they're smoking. And the guys are coming down, you know, from the band to eat.
I was fine at the hotel because I had this hotel I stayed all the time. And I always carry my little thing that you cook with. And I was there fixing some mustard greens.
Yeah, she can cook and she can fish, all that stuff. She don't get seasick. We was on a cruise ship, everybody was seasick. She was like, child, I wish I could throw my line. She wanted to go fishing on the cruise ship, right? You know, it's the huge thing, it's about as big as a city block. She said, I'd like to throw my line in. I'm like, Shirley, we're all trying to keep our lunch down. You know, she wants to go fishing.
We love seafood, and so we did a lot of fishing and everything as a family. So it was a lot of fun. It was good.
Sometimes we watched the cooking shows together on TV, so she, you know, we'd be like in San Francisco, right? It'd be the frugal gourmet. She'll call me up, child, did you see what he did to that fish? And, you know, our mouths are watering. So.
good experiences growing up, good memories. And the musicians too, they were like family.
We did a session at Shirley's home called The Main Ingredient. And the main ingredient was about vibes, the vibes of good music and good food, fueled by interaction. And the interaction was with these really good musicians.
I didn't want to go back into the studio at the time. I just wanted to stay home. And I just wanted to have a little piece of what I remember from many years ago. And when the guys used to come over to my house, after we played the gigs, they'd come to my house. Always I had some food on the stove.
And she provided all these different types of dishes, you know? So we just had fun and did some recording. And it was called The Main Ingredient. But the main ingredient was Shirley, you know? Because without her, it wouldn't have happened.
Shirley's natural talents attracted many notable musicians, among them The Cue.
That's meeting Quincy and meeting so many musicians that I've cherished, you know, over the years. And it's great. I was with John Levy, my dear friend. He was my manager at the time. He called me one day and said, "How would you like to do an album with Quincy Jones?" I said, "Are you kidding?" "Of course, I'm here in Washington." He said, "Okay, send me a list of tunes." That was it. Okay, and he said, "Send me who you want." And then I had to pick out all these musicians that I've seen on the album covers that I love, right? You know, it was simple like that. Then I got to the studio and I looked at all these people who were there. I said, "John, I can't go." He said, "You going in there?" He opened the door and just pushed me right on in. And I was scared to death.
She's done so much. She did the movie. She sang the theme For the Love of Ivy.
For Love of Ivy and Abby Lincoln was the star. Sidney Poitier was the star. I didn't see the movie until he called and said, "You come out to California." And I said, "Yes." There was a lot of money involved, you know. But I said, "But send me the music." He said, "I want you to be a part of it." It was a great feeling. You know, after so many days, we finally got into the music when we went in to record For Love of Ivy. I was in the studio because I could see, and Frank Sinatra and four or five men in dark suits passed by, and I said, "Is that Frank Sinatra?" to myself. "Yeah," and he waved, and did like this, you know. Which kind of knocked me out. And then I realized that was Frank Sinatra. But the music is beautiful. You know, Quincy is beautiful.
As a Washingtonian, everyone experienced the landmark Howard Theater. Shirley's memories came in the ninth month of her pregnancy.
I've been so many places in my life. There was some segregation going on and I used to go to listen to this big band, and I said, I don't want to do that. You know, what it feels like to play with a big band. So I got to know Bill Potts, and he asked me, will he play? You know, so I ended up playing and singing. You know, I used to have a ball. I used to look forward to going to rehearsals and hanging out with, I guess, maybe 20 guys, you know. And everything was cool. I had rehearsed Porgy and Bess, the whole suite. Now I'm all big. I mean, I was so big. You know, I had a big baby, you know. And they were getting ready to do this Porgy and Bess at the Howard Theater. The whole band was surprised to see me, you know, because they knew I was going to have this baby. Shep didn't want me to go. I said, I'm going.
Fish have jumped in.
I mean, I was great. So
the cotton is high.
I made kind of like a tent dress.
Your daddy's,
you know, from here up, I look great. You know, but
and
then
your
it's,
ma is good looking.
I'm here. And I'm waiting to go on, you know. So they went on into it, and they announced me, and I came on out and joined the band and started having some labor pains, which I thought maybe it was gas, right? But I made it through. Made it through the end of the concert. As I'm leaving, I'm starting to feel like this is it, you know. And I was talking with the guys and everything, and every now and then a little something would say, you better go. You better go. So that was how it did the thing.
Sun lights up the daytime, moon lights up the night, and I light up when you call my name, 'cause I know you're gonna treat me right. Now give it fever.
Shirley sings the way she talks, and she talks the way she sings. Her style is bare bone. There's a great deal of polyrhythmic rhythms, which means that, say, certain rhythms imposed on the other. You say you might have twos against threes or threes against four, polyrhythmic. And definitely, harmonic, the harmonic structures that she uses are definitely avant-garde.
Romeo told Juliet, he said, Julie, baby, you're my flame, thou giveth fever.
If I'm going to do a concert, I'll make a note four or five tunes. But then one thing leads to another. This tune makes me think of that tune, and it goes on like that.
Shirley is like a conductor. Shirley is conductor. She conducts with her body, with her hands, and with her voice, and with her pauses, and with her phrasing, she conducts. So you have to pay close attention to Shirley.
Charles hasn't played with anyone but me for 26 years. Steve, every now and then, you know, he's a little hot rodder.
I've been with Shirley for 17 years now. And I think my contribution to the trio is my personal life experience in response to the songs that she sings. My mom used to have something on it that said, sometimes the best man for a job is a woman, you know. And I believe that, not just because my mom had it on her desk, but because I do work with, you know, a wonderful boss, and she's a woman. She's the best man for the job, whatever. She knows what she wants. She knows how to get it out of you in a way that she means business about it, but it's also, she has patience. You'll get it.
We're like a family, you know. Steve and Charles argue all the time. I'm the leader. I'm always arguing. But we go on the bandstand. We move. Sometimes it gets so good musically, we're moving as one.
Oh, it's a very dreamy situation to be on the stage with her or you know, whoever. She's singing these songs, and you hear them over and over. And you look, and I look over, I've looked over at her at many times when she's singing a song, and her eyes will fill up with tears, you know. And so when I hear her music, that's what I hear. I hear her saying when she's singing a song. I hear, I see, you know, I see the love, I see the want, or I see the disappointment, and I see all that.
Sometimes we can, it's almost like we breathe together, you know. Like we've been, sometimes it's so good, it's like heaven. Sometimes it's when it's really good, it's like having sex, you know. And we breathe together, we move as one, you know. And that's when you get the goose pimples and you don't know how to get out of a song, and you step inside.
Yeah, we're definitely soulmates. If you can describe the experience or the relationship between two, three people, whatever, where there's very little conversation about why you're doing what you're doing, you just know, you just understand.
She doesn't sound like any of our great women singers. She sounds like Shirley. And she's gotten great acclaim for being Shirley.
It's wonderful that she's getting the notoriety, but she was accomplished decades ago.
Yeah. I was very lucky. I was on the end, you know. I was at the end there. I was there when I heard Adonna Washington, and I was there to hear Sarah Vaughan and Carmen McRae, these singers, and this is just for the music, the singers, you know. I was there, you know. I heard Dinah Washington's lyricism just ring like a bell, and I heard what Sarah did, you know, with melody, and I kind of feel for, number one, the singers that are coming along now. They should have been there, you know. It's for the musicians. I almost feel the same way, you know. I wish they could have been around to be, just be involved.
Back in another lifetime, you know, when all the musicians, the jazz musicians that were in Mom's group, like Quincy Jones and Miles Davis, everybody was kind of going into, I don't know how you phrase it, maybe fusion jazz, or I don't know all the terms, but just kind of changing styles. And everybody said, come on, Shirley, you got to get into this and get into that. And she really didn't feel, her heart wasn't in it. So regardless of who said what, she just continued to do what she felt in her heart was what she felt was important to her.
That was cool. I had common sense. I paid attention, I watched what was going on down in the business, and I was a woman who had to book her own band and manage her own musicians and what have you, and I paid attention, but that was cool. There were times when I would have to, you know, go back to get the money for the week's pay. You know, but then I learned very quickly to tell my husband, you come on the payday, and he would be standing outside the door. Number one, my husband was always around. But we've been married for 42 years. He was always around, but he was always, see, if you come on home, we had to go through all this. I'm not having any more babies. I got to have my music. I got to have this.
Over 40 years, performing, arranging, recording, qualifying her greatness on her own terms, in her own time, Shirley Horne reluctantly accepts a genuine label.
Yes, I'm a jazz legend. I've been out here long. I feel fine with that. You know, I've done some good music, some things I'm very proud of, but I'm still searching for that next step. I've got to make another step as far as the music is concerned that's going to satisfy me.
So at this point, with all the notoriety and the Grammys like icing on the cake, it's just nice to see it's like a groundswell of Shirley Horne appreciation that's finally coming to fruition.
I'm very proud of my sister, and I enjoy hearing her play, you know, and I have followed, you know, her accomplishments whenever I can keep up with her, you know.
I have an underground that's been with me for almost all my life.
It's always been a cult now. She's always had a cult following, but now it's just a bigger group and a bigger group. And it's wonderful to see her get the recognition, the worldwide recognition that she's deserved.
I feel like they're with me because I'm trying to, see, I have a picture, and I want you to feel and see the picture I'm trying to paint for you. I want you to feel what I'm feeling. I want you to see what I'm seeing.
My, how the time goes by.
I like the feeling that I have when I sit down with the guys and we know exactly what we're going to do. Then we can enjoy the music, you know. So, Sassared and Blowed.
The thing that we enjoy the most as a trio is that we've been together for so long that we're not tired of each other, but we find joy in that we know each other musically, you know. And so it's a pleasure to perform.
Music is an all-consuming thing. It eats your life, you know. I can't, sometimes I said, I'm gonna take 6 months off, right? After about 2 weeks, I get antsy. I call the guys. Guys, come on over, let's.
So you have to really listen closely to Shirley, to what she's really doing. I mean, the beauty of it. You know, that's what makes Shirley, Shirley.
I dare not guess.
And always I have music in my head, always.
She's very devoted to her fans. And I think she likes to give back to them. And the only way you give back to them is to go out and perform. So I think that's why she wouldn't completely stop.
I say, well, I'm going to retire. I'm going to stop. And so it's all this stuff like that. I'll get antsy, and it'll build up in me. And I have to play. I have to relieve my body and soul, which means I've got to play. I gotta play, but I gotta sing.
Is it really love? Is it really love? Oh.
Shirley Valerie Horne, an accomplished pianist and jazz vocalist, has fulfilled her goal of creating good music and enriched the lives of others with her cool, classy, sultry sounds. Her musical journey has truly been, in the words of her grandmother, sassered and blowed.
This is what it's all about. The music. The main ingredients. Sassared means, well, this is an old country expression. I've heard my grandmother. When she puts a plate in front of you, she says it's all sassared and blowed.